Good evening. You're watching Left, Right and Center. I'm Nidhi Razdan. Tonight, round 5 of the 7-phase election is finally over. And for the first time, a senior BJP leader, Ram Madhav, has talked about the possibility of the BJP reaching a majority with its allies from the NDA. So the question we're asking tonight is whether regional players are going to be kingmaker in this election. That's coming up over the next 60 minutes. Well, the world's biggest election, as you know, is underway. 7 rounds, 5 of them have finally been completed. And after today, nearly 80% of India has voted. There are about 118 seats still left over the next 2 phases on the 13th and the 19th of May before counting on the 23rd. This was the turnout today, 62.56 in phase 5 compared to 61.5 in 2014. So a little bit higher than the 2014 general election. 51 seats voted today across 7 states and, as I said, nearly 80% of the country now complete. Now, these 3 phases, 5, 6 and 7, that includes today, are essentially particularly crucial for the BJP because most of these seats were won by the BJP and their allies last time. Out of these 169 seats, 116 were won by the BJP and its allies. So it's very important for them to hold on to this and maybe do better if they want to replicate the results of 2014, which is what they're saying that they will do. In 2014, the BJP alone won 39 of these 51 seats that voted today. And that is why it has become so important. Now, the other thing that happened today was Ram Madhav's interview to Bloomberg, where he was asked, are you going to win a majority again? And he said, we are confident. We are confident of securing an absolute majority, either independently, the BJP itself, or at least with our NDA alliance partners. We are quite confident of securing a majority. Now, this is important because it is the first time a senior BJP leader has talked about the possibility of reaching that majority mark with allies and not just the BJP alone. So that's set off a flurry of speculation about what the BJP's internal assessment is about this general election. And while that's happening on one hand, on the other, we're also seeing now the murmurs of a federal front without the Congress and the BJP also gathering pace. You had KCR, the Chief Minister of Telangana, making those moves today.
2 phases, 118 seats left to vote. But already, parties appear to be looking at shoring up their numbers, including a possible non-BJP, non-Congress front. For the first time, a top BJP leader, Ram Madhav, acknowledged the possibility of the BJP not getting a majority itself, but with allies. His exact words, "We are confident of securing an absolute majority either independently, BJP itself, or at least with our NDA alliance partners, we are quite confident of securing a majority."
सरकार एनडीए की बनेगी, प्रधानमंत्री मोदी जी बनेंगे, उसमें कोई दो राय नहीं है. हमारा अनुमान है कि हम 300 के ऊपर जाएंगे, लेकिन एनडीए और बीजेपी बहुमत के नजदीक आ जाएगी, लेकिन शायद कुछ सीटें कम पड़ती है, तो हम सब है ना.
एंड द स्टेटमेंट इज वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट मेड बाय श्री राम माधव. आई सपोर्ट हिज स्टेटमेंट. इफ दे गेट मेजोरिटी इट्स ऑल राइट. इफ दे डोंट गेट मेजोरिटी, as Mr. Madhav has said, we are ready to cooperate.
On the same day, the Prime Minister in Odisha, standing next to Naveen Patnaik, praising the Chief Minister for cyclone relief work, being seen as an attempt to thaw the chill of a bitter election campaign, with the BJD being seen as one of the parties that could support the BJP if required.
पिछले 7-8 दिन से लगातार perfect coordination रहा केंद्र और राज्य के बीच में. कम्युनिकेशन बहुत ही परफेक्ट रहा. राज्य सरकार की टीम भी बहुत ही प्रोएक्टिव भी थी, रिस्पॉन्सिव भी थी. नवीन बाबू ने बहुत अच्छा प्लान किया है. भारत सरकार उसमें उनके साथ रह करके सारी चीजों को आगे बढ़ा पाएगी.
बट अदर्स टू हैव बिगन द पॉलिटिकल चेस गेम्स. द तेलंगाना चीफ मिनिस्टर रीचिंग आउट टू चीफ मिनिस्टर्स ऑफ केरला एंड कर्नाटका, as well as DMK's chief MK Stalin. 2 of these 3 are Congress allies.
Here at the Cliff House, it's politics over dinner, as K. Chandrasekhar Rao, along with his family, have called on Pinrai Vijayan and his family at his official residence. But sources close to KCR say this is an important meeting with the federal front as an objective, the third alternate at the center as an objective. But sources close to Pinrai Vijayan have called this just a courtesy visit of a chief minister of a state who's in Kerala for a 2 days break. But in the neighboring state of Karnataka, the chief minister, H.D. Kumaraswamy, has again called KCR's call to him just a courtesy call.
But for the anti-Modi coalition, the question of leadership remains a challenge. Today, Mayawati dropped a big hint that she is ready to play a bigger role in Delhi, saying that if made Prime Minister, she will stand from her old Lok Sabha seat in UP. Either way, it's clear that even before the results are out, the Game of Thrones has begun. An NDTV Bureau report.
So lots to talk about tonight. Now that we are literally in the fag end of this campaign, we have a terrific panel with us this evening. Joining us tonight, we have Mr. Chandan Mitra, senior leader of the Trinamool Congress, Lalita Kumaramangalam of the BJP, Mr. Sudhindra Bhadoria of the BSP, Mr. Pranav Jha of the Congress Party. We have Mr. Deshratan Nigam, who's of course a political analyst and the sympathizer of the BJP, Mr. K.C. Tyagi of the JDU, and Nilanjan Sarkar of Ashoka University is with us tonight as well. And let me just get a sense first from you, Nilanjan Sarkar, because everyone's trying to talk numbers, you know, every party is getting its own feedback at this point. Now that we are at the fag end of this election, does it look like to you that this could be an election where the regional parties will play kingmaker, or that it will be a very decisive verdict one way or the other?
I think based on what we're seeing right now, it doesn't feel like a wave as we sort of saw in 2014. So even with a small change in vote share for the BJP across states, you would see a major need for allies for the BJP in order to form government. So even if we take the opinion polls that people saw before the election, even if those hold true, it's clear that the BJP will require some assistance from allies.
And that's in that sense, you're saying Ram Madhav has spoken perhaps a home truth today.
I think so. I mean, I think that with the SP and the BSP coming together, even fairly optimistic projections within the BJP have them losing a number of seats within UP. And just taking that tally alone would drop the BJP below a single party majority that it got in 2014.
Lalita Kumaramangalam, what do you make of Ram Madhav's comments today? There's been a lot of debate and discussion on it, but it is the first time a senior leader of the BJP is talking about the possibility of getting a majority with the help of allies. Is he just being realistic, pragmatic at putting it out there, or was it, you know, perhaps politically not prudent to do so?
Nidhi, let's remember that the BJP is already part of an alliance. The NDA is standing for elections. Yes, the major party and partner in it is the BJP. From all appearances and in the absence of exit polls, let me add, it looks like the BJP is heading towards forming the government again. Now, again, once again, let me say that in the absence of exit polls, all of us are speculating really about what may or what may not happen. Now, if you look at the Indian electoral history, you'll see that except perhaps on very rare occasions, one or two, after emergency when they voted out that particular prime minister, and in 2014 when there was a Modi wave, and maybe one or two other elections when Indira Gandhi ji was gunned down, the voters of India tend to look not just at caste and creed, etc., but also at their own regional aspirations and the chances of especially in the south, the regional parties having a stake in the central government or not. Remember that the DMK was with both the NDA and the UPA 1 and 2. They were in four successive governments. So much like that, I think there could well be a position where if the BJP doesn't get a majority, which quite frankly, let me tell you, we're quite confident of getting on our own, even though it is true that we will probably lose a few seats in UP as compared to the last time, because last time it was hardly a contest, it was a sweep. This time the BJP has been in power for 5 years, so like any other government that's been in power for 5 years, we have contesting much harder perhaps than we did in 2014. Now, Mr. Ram Madhav is a very senior leader of the party itself. He is not in the government, as you know, but he is a very senior leader of the party. And he's been in charge of very crucial states like Jammu and Kashmir and the entire Northeast. He's also traveled widely in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, which is where he comes from. And I think he was just being merely very practical, that even though we are confident of making it on our own, we do know that we can depend on our allies.
Okay. So being practical, Mr. Bhadauria, is that what how you saw Ram Madhav's comments today? That he was being practical, and what does that then tell you? You know, when a senior leader of the BJP makes a comment like that with two phases still to go, what do you think that reflects? You know, in terms of the political messaging that is there.
I think Ram Madhav has been frank enough to admit that the BJP is losing this time, and he's just trying to put a brave face by saying that we will, with the help of others from the government. Having said that, let me also put certain records straight, that the BJP last time won overwhelmingly in the entire northern India before the Vindhyas. Now, having said that, I must also say this, that in UP alone, they will lose very heavily. And moving to states like Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand, Maharashtra, Gujarat, and here also, they have lost very recently in three states. They will be losing considerably in these states. So I don't see them giving such numbers that they can form the government with any number of people who they may like to, you know, bring on board. Therefore, one certain thing which emerges, the takeaway from the statement of Madhav, is that Modi ji is going out and a new government is on the horizon. That is for us to see now.
All right. Well, that is your claim. Mr. K.C. Tyagi of the JDU is with us, and he's an NDA ally. Tyagi ji, I just have a question out of curiosity first, which is that where is Nitish Kumar in this campaign? Kya ho gaya unko? Matlab us din wo manch pe bhi baithe the Pradhan Mantri ke saath, and he was absolutely quiet. That video went viral. Lekin Nitish Kumar is baar prachar kyun nahi kar rahe? Aapne to manifesto bhi jari nahi kiya. Banaya hai, lekin usko publish nahi kiya hai.
मैं आपसे मेरी असहमति है, वो दिन में कम से कम 5 जनसभाएं करते हैं, और ये बिहार के मुख्यमंत्री का चुनाव नहीं है, ये देश के प्रधानमंत्री का चुनाव है। प्रधानमंत्री जब मंच पर होते हैं तो नीतीश कुमार जी भी यही कहते हैं कि हमारे नेता नरेंद्र मोदी जी हैं और अगले प्रधानमंत्री ये होंगे, तो उनकी विजिबिलिटी बहुत ज़्यादा है, नंबर वन। नंबर टू, जहाँ तक उनके असहज होने का सवाल है, आपके चैनल पे मैं पहले भी कह चुका हूँ कि एनडीए का एजेंडा अलग है और बीजेपी का एजेंडा अलग है। हम उनके एजेंडे का स्वागत करते हैं, उनको हमारे एजेंडे का स्वागत करना चाहिए, यही तालमेल की राजनीति का अंश है। जहाँ तक तीसरी बात है कि राम माधव का जो बयान है उसको तोड़ मरोड़ने की जरूरत नहीं है। उन्होंने कहा है कि या तो हम मेजोरिटी प्राप्त करेंगे और अगर कुछ कमी रहती है तो हम अलाइज पार्टी के साथ, और पार्टियों के साथ नहीं कहा उन्होंने, अलाइज के, शिवसेना, एजीपी, जेडीयू, अन्ना डीएमके, अकाली दल वगैरह वगैरह वगैरह। और जो मेरे मित्र सुधीर भदौरिया कह रहे हैं, और ललिता जी ने भी एग्री किया है, मैं भी यूपी से हूँ, मैं भी 6 लोकसभा के चुनाव वहाँ से लड़े हैं, बिल्कुल मैं मानता हूँ कि सपा और बसपा का गठबंधन बहुत मजबूत है, लेकिन ये मायावती जी को या अखिलेश यादव जी को या गहलोत जी को या कमलनाथ जी को मुख्य प्रधानमंत्री बनाने के लिए चुनाव नहीं हो रहा है। या तो नरेंद्र मोदी जी रहेंगे या नहीं रहेंगे, इसके बीच में चुनाव है, और जो विरोधी दल है मेजोरिटी में वो कह रहे मोदी हटाओ। तो इसमें जो राज्यों की ताकतवर लीडरशिप भी है, मैं विद ऑल माई रेस्पेक्ट टू मायावती एंड अखिलेश यादव, राज्यों की मजबूत लीडरशिप जो है वो प्रधानमंत्री की दावेदार नहीं है। अभी भी मायावती जी का नाम जो है गठबंधन की तरफ से नहीं आया है, ममता जी का आया है।
आपकी बात सही है कि दिस इलेक्शन इज अबाउट नरेंद्र मोदी मोर देन इट्स नॉट अबाउट चीफ मिनिस्टर्स ऑफ स्टेट। बट मिस्टर त्यागी, आपको नहीं लगता कि जब ये पहली बार बीजेपी का कोई सीनियर नेता है, जैसे राम माधव जी हैं, और जिन्होंने पहली बार ऐसी बात करी है कि अलायंस भी हो सकती है? मतलब अभी तक तो बीजेपी अपनी मेजोरिटी की बात कर रही है, हमने 600 का नंबर भी सुना था।
ये तो अगर कोई नहीं मानता है तो फिर मैं क्या कह सकता हूँ, मैं तो खुद ही कबूल कर रहा हूँ। मैं यूपी का रहने वाला हूँ, मैं वहां से लोकसभा का एमपी रहा हूँ, मैं जिम्मेदारी के साथ कहता हूँ ऑन रिकॉर्ड कि हमारी सीटें कम होंगी,
बीजेपी की सीटें कम होंगी वहां पर, लेकिन इतनी कम होंगी कि सरकार बनाने की स्थिति में एनडीए नहीं होगा, मैं ऐसा नहीं मानता हूं। तो राम माधव जी का यही कहना जो आपके उस पर लिखा हुआ है स्क्रीन पर, देट दे विल मेक गवर्नमेंट विद द अलाइज, तो अलाइज में मैंने नाम गिनवाए आप,
नहीं नहीं सही बात, नंबर एक। I was just asking about the timing of the statement because that is what you know sort of raised eyebrows today. And Chandan Mitra, how did you see Ram Madhav's statement today? What is the message according to you?
Well, I was surprised that a senior leader.
Nidhi, if you'll allow me, I'll say a couple
back,
words after
moment.
Chandan.
I just get a quick comment from everyone and come back to you. Yeah.
Senior leader and somebody who is respected as a strategist, has all India experience, should have made this type of comment, which is liable to misinterpretation among the BJP cadre and will be seized upon by the opposition and Gathbandhan people particularly as showing that, look, BJP has given up. They are already talking about allies, allies within the NDA. Tomorrow they will talk about allies from outside NDA also. So in that scenario, this somewhere reflects a lack of confidence in the final run. And so this is surprising, although this is something which many people say, Ram Madhav ji is not alone, but to voice it for a senior leader at this stage, juncture of the election, is a bit surprising. That's all I would
Pranav
say.
Chow, let me get your first comment on that. And I also the fact that you also have these murmurs of now the Federal Front that are back and KCR leading that effort to have a non-Congress, non-BJP front. You're smiling, but is that something, I mean, anything can happen in Indian politics?
Why not? See, first thing first, we know for sure that there isn't going to be a BJP government.
We don't, but we're not.
I at least see with my experience in politics that it will be at least a reversal of 80 to 100 seats in the fortunes of BJP. They will, of course, they have the likelihood of being the largest party and with allies around. But the moment you bring in the allies, then it becomes the open game. Then the allies are not compelled to be, you know, tied to BJP, because then there are then other backhand works gets into action, like Mamata ji will get active. SP, BSP, you've seen the overtures and you see the language suddenly today. And they have had a past. But what I'm saying, what you need to understand that the forces opponent to BJP will keep primarily one thing in mind, and that thing is that they all fought on anti-BJP agenda. They will keep that in mind, that in future they will have to go to the people. So they will not get into an arrangement where, you know, they'll be blamed for being having compromised their ideologies. So there, I think Congress will have an advantage, because as an anchor party, an opponent anchor party, and not actually taking stake at power, because that's not the primary goal, and we have
but
said that.
But ultimately, that depends on how many seats you get.
Yes, and why should we get good amount of seats? We are fighting well. We are the who is Prime Minister attacking every day? Why is he doing that if we are irrelevant, isn't it? So we are saying that you don't know. It's an open game. We are fighting well. We are fighting on issues. Why is Prime Minister retaliating every day? Because he's in a bind. He's hitting back. He's angry. Why is he angry? Because it's slipping out of his hand.
Okay, but Mr. Nigam, is that what it is? A couple of things here. How did you see Ram Madhav's comments, and how do you then see the Prime Minister's campaign? I mean, some say it reflects what Mr. Jha says, that, you know, there's a certain nervousness. Others would say that's just how the BJP campaigns, and you can't read too much into
it. See, that's the way Mr. Modi and Amit Shah campaign, and it is not only in this election, the previous elections as well. Now, Mr. Madhav's, you know, statement from his side may be clear, but if a layman hears it, it is open to interpretation. That is where I don't agree with that kind of a statement coming at this point of time. My estimate is that BJP itself is coming to majority on its own, the kind of reports that we get from the ground. And at the same time, what Mr. Jha said, that you contested against each other, and that logic falls flat in the context of Karnataka. They fought hammer and tongs with JDS, and then they came together. So post-poll alliances are a distinct possibility. Even if BJP gets majority on its own, there is a distinct possibility the allies who are not even there in NDA may come and support
and which
it's entirely possible.
There's a clear possibility also if you are there. And why BJP does that? To make it far more broad-based government. So for future election, it helps them. So end of the day, this statement was not called for at this point of time, one. Secondly, what Mr. Madhav thought about it was probably that, you know, it's so far as he's concerned, he may be very clear, coming on its own, majority, BJP getting it, or with allies. But there is some kind of, you know, interpretative value to it. So that
would you think is it was not needed at
not
this time?
Not needed at this point.
I just don't want to ask, when you say that the BJP will come back to power on its own, where are the seats going to come from? Let's just look at the numbers. If you look at just the Hindi heartland, you know, the BJP won 88% of the seats, Nilanjan, right? So, like UP 71, Madhya Pradesh was 27 out of 29, Rajasthan was 25 out of 25. Look at other states like Gujarat, 26 out of 26, Delhi was 7 out of 7. I mean, Chhattisgarh was 10 out of 11. It's not going to be easy to replicate that and you know, get a majority on their own. Where does it add up? I mean, they may make gains in West Bengal, but where else?
I think that's exactly right. I mean, if we actually look at sort of geographic specificity, the BJP itself won about 70% of its seats from only six states in 2014. Bihar, UP, MP, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Maharashtra. So without that kind of sweeping performance, it's quite difficult to see. The other thing that's very noticeable about the states, other than UP and Bihar, is that those are states in which the BJP has locked horns with the Congress in sort of a direct fight. So insofar as the BJP is unable to get exactly those kinds of numbers again, the Congress is actually gaining at the BJP's expense in those kinds of places.
Well, just to get Mr. Bhadauria in on that, Mr. Bhadauria, where do you think the BJP could make up these numbers? I mean, you are, of course, convinced, you know, the opposite of what Mr. Nigam is saying. But just looking at beyond Uttar Pradesh, it's very difficult to get 25 out of 25, say, in a state like Rajasthan, isn't it?
Well, they have just few months back lost in Rajasthan, in Madhya Pradesh, in Jharkhand. In Jharkhand, they have lost, in Chhattisgarh, they have lost miserably. In the by-elections in UP, in four constituencies, Phulpur, Gorakhpur, Kairana, Noorpur, they were completely wiped off. I think BJP is going to have heavy losses in the states where they had won last time. I don't see any chance of BJP, and in Bengal, I think Mamata Banerjee is going to do well, same with Naveen Patnaik, and the Prime Minister himself has said, Naveen Babu ne bahut achha kaam kiya hai. So if Naveen Babu has done achha kaam, he'll get good results also. And therefore, I must say that Modi ji is on his way out.
Well, he could be saying Naveen Babu ne bahut achha kaam kiya hai, because Naveen Babu might be a potential ally after the elections. But, you know...
But that was in the context of the cycle.
I know. It was. But there's a lot that is being read into every meeting that happens right now. Courtesy meetings are never courtesy meetings. But Lalitha Kumaramangalam, if indeed this ends up becoming a government where the BJP is more dependent on allies, which now even you say Mr. Ram Madhav was perhaps being pragmatic, it would be a very different government for Mr. Modi to run. You think that he's going to handle those pulls and pressures of alliances well?
Maybe let's be clear about one thing. Even in 2014, when we had swept the country and we didn't really need our allies, we still kept the NDA together. We have had ministers from other allied parties, and whatever may be our problems, they were sorted out. Now, in a country as large and as diverse with caste, creed, and I mean so many other regional aspirations, so many other differences, we've kept our flock together. And with regard to losing some seats in one state or a couple of other states, well, we'll probably make it up in other states. Example, in the Northeast, we will break ground this time definitely in West Bengal and Orissa. And we're not going to do as badly as a lot of people want us to or expect us to in the states which we had swept the last time. And I'm sure Mr. Modi, if what you say or if what many people seem to hope from the opposition comes true, that we will need the help of our allies in forming a government, which personally none of us feel is going to be necessary. Regardless of that, we have tied up with our allies before the election. If you look at the other side, see what's happening in UP, see what's happening in Bihar.
Sorry,
and
just to
these
interrupt
are two
you there,
big Hindi
sorry,
heartland
just to
states.
Interrupt you there briefly.
Nobody
the,
really knows
the
who's
fact
fighting
is you also had
the other
serious
side in
problems
both
with your NDA
UP.
Allies. You had problems with the Shiv Sena, Chandrababu Naidu left. You had the AGP that was furious until it came back a little later. You've had a problem with a series of NDA allies over the last couple of years.
Nidhi,
no, the point is, you've also managed to reach out to the Sena, for example,
Nidhi, the
just before the,
is known
just before the election.
Mercurial.
Ma'am, just one second. So one of the common, and even the Akali Dal has, you know, raised rumblings from time to time. I think the point is that with a big majority, your allies were pretty upset at various different points in the NDA. When you're going to be more dependent on those allies, will that style of, if you are, then will that style of functioning of your top leadership have to be very different? I mean, Mr. Modi and Amit Shah.
Nidhi, let's get one thing very clear. The Shiv Sena is known to be a very mercurial partner, but we've been partners for a long, long time now, both in the, with the, at the state and at the central level. With regard to our other allies, for example, the ADMK, of course, there have been ups and downs, but that's not true just for the BJP. That's true of any alliance, regardless of whether it's the Congress or the BJP or, you know, in any for any other party. With regard to what you're saying about, and I quote, put this in quotes, the style of functioning of Mr. Modi and Mr. Amit Shah, it's actually Mr. Modi really who's the crucial person. This election is being fought to see that Mr. Modi becomes the Prime Minister again. And we are very confident of seeing that he will come in as Prime Minister. Mr. Modi has also been the Chief Minister of a state for many, many years. And he knows extremely well, you know, how administration works. So I
yeah,
don't
but he's
think
never
there's
had to
going
depend
to be any
on,
problem
he's
there.
He's never had to depend
All
on allies.
Flex their
he's actually
now
always
then,
won
maybe.
Elections on his own. He's never had to
no,
really
I don't think it's a
depend
question
on allies for support. And why are you not giving credit to Amit Shah? What happened?
Nidhi, Mr. Amit Shah is the party president now. What will happen to him is none of, I mean, it's really, again, it's just speculation. But that's not the point. The point is that it's Mr. Modi who's been prime minister and it's him who people are going to opt for as a prime minister for the second time. Now, when it comes to allies, it's a question of codependency. Let's not forget. If when there are allies, regardless of everything else, allies are as dependent on the major partner as the major partner is dependent on them. And if what you're suggesting is that we don't get an absolute majority currently with what the NDA partners are, and that we will be looking at outside partners, I think it's too premature to talk about that now.
Actually, that's not, that is not what is being asked. Because there is a big difference between the BJP claiming a majority on its own until now and Ram Madhav talking about a majority with NDA allies. No, I'm saying there's a big difference, and I think that's what Mr. Nikam was also trying to say earlier. Till now, the BJP has claimed it doesn't need anybody else.
Which is what we expect to do or with our allies.
But I do want to ask Mr. KC Tyagi then, that you are in the NDA, you know how Mr. Modi and Mr. Amit Shah function. You made a statement just now on this program, Mr. Tyagi, that ek toh jo BJP ka manifesto hai, NDA ka manifesto alag hai. Kya, matlab, what are the different points? Matlab, kya wo cheez hai jo BJP ke manifesto mein hai, jo aapki party ke manifesto mein ya NDA ke manifesto mein nahi hai? Is that Article 370, 35A, for example?
देखिए अटल जी के नेतृत्व में जब एनडीए बना था उससे पहले बीजेपी अलग थी और जनता दल यू या समता पार्टी अलग थी और जॉर्ज फर्नांडिस के कन्वीनर बने थे उस समय ये कुछ मुद्दे अलग कर दिए गए थे। पिछली बार जब एनडीए बना है बीजेपी की अकेले सरकार थी, उनको किसी की कोई जरूरत नहीं थी। अकेले सरकार भी चली जब हम कौन सी पार्टी है जो एनडीए में नहीं रही? टीएमसी उसमें रह चुकी है, नेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस उसमें रह चुकी है, अकाली दल रह चुका है, टीडीपी रह चुकी है, केसीआर रह चुकी है, उसमें आसाम गण परिषद रह चुकी है, डीएमके रह चुकी है, उसमें बीएसपी रह चुकी है, कम्युनिस्टों को छोड़कर के जिनकी मार्जिनल यूटिलिटी बची नहीं है,
और कांग्रेस को
कोई पार्टी ऐसी नहीं है जो एनडीए में नहीं रह चुकी है। और हाँ, कांग्रेस तो मेन अपोजिशन पार्टी है। और दूसरा, हम लोगों के बीच में उस समय एनडीए में किसी सवाल पर कोई मतभेद नहीं था। हम पिछले 50 सालों से अपोजिशन में जनसंघ के साथ भी काम करते रहे, बीजेपी के साथ भी काम करते रहे, हमें कोई दिक्कत नहीं होती। लेकिन जो हमारे कोर इश्यूज हैं उसको बीजेपी जानती है, जो बीजेपी के कोर इश्यूज हैं वो हम जानते हैं,
वो अपनी राय रखते हैं, हम अपनी राय रखते हैं, और सलाह मशवरे से और अच्छे काम होते हैं।
लेकिन त्यागी जी, मेरा सवाल ये है कि अगर अगर बीजेपी को, अगर इस बार बीजेपी को अपनी मेजोरिटी नहीं आती है एंड दे विल नीड द सपोर्ट ऑफ पार्टीज लाइक योरसेल्फ जो ऑलरेडी एनडीए में है, दैट मीन्स यू विल हैव अ ग्रेटर से इन कीपिंग दिस गवर्नमेंट अलाइव, तो कुछ बदलाव आना चाहिए जिस तरह से अलायंस को मतलब द वे द अलायंस इज बीइंग रन।
बल्कि एक तो निगम जी हैं और वो कह रहे हैं कि उनकी अलग से बीजेपी की मेजोरिटी आएगी, फिर तो नहीं है। लेकिन अगर कोई एनडीए बनता है जिसमें जेडीयू भी शामिल है, तो हम चाहते हैं कि जो पुराना एजेंडा है अटल जी के समय का, एक कॉमन मिनिमम प्रोग्राम जरूर बनना चाहिए जो जो सभी पार्टीज के लिए, बीजेपी के लिए भी, अलाय के लिए, सभी के लिए अच्छा है।
तो दैट मींस कंटेंशियस इश्यूज आर ऑफ द टेबल, क्योंकि वाजपेयी जी के टाइम में तो आर्टिकल 370 और राम मंदिर तो अलग किया गया था ना, वो तो खाली बीजेपी का एजेंडा था, एनडीए का नहीं था।
प्रधानमंत्री श्री नरेंद्र मोदी कई अवसर पर स्वयं कह चुके हैं, और ये मैं निगम जी की उपस्थिति में कहना चाहता हूँ कि अयोध्या का मामला अभी कोर्ट के अंदर है, इसलिए इस पर कोई बात नहीं हो सकती। यही अटल जी कहते थे,
तो बीजेपी के मैनिफेस्टो में तो है। हाँ।
वही हम कहते हैं कि नहीं, मैनिफेस्टो में तो भारतीय जनता पार्टी का मैनिफेस्टो जिसमें बीजेपी शामिल थी उसमें आर्टिकल 370 को बना के रखेंगे, जिसमें अटल जी थे, नानाजी देशमुख थे और अडवाणी थे, एंड दैट वाज बैक्ड बाय आरएसएस आल्सो,
look to NDA allies to get a majority and form a government, I'm sure that they'll work out something like what it was, as Tyagi ji is mentioning, during Atal ji's time, in which there will be two sets of agendas. One will remain BJP's agenda as the single largest party at least, and the other will be the NDA's agenda, in which some of these contentious issues will be kept aside, like they have done in Bihar, for instance. In Bihar, the reason why the manifesto has not been issued by the JDU is because there are some contentious issues like this, what you mentioned. And therefore, I think JDU, Mr. K.C. Tyagi will be able to clarify this further, decided to leave it aside for the moment so that it does not mar the election atmosphere.
But can I ask you, what is the Trinamool's position on the federal front? Because Mamata Banerjee has met KCR in the past, and you know, she's been talking to the Congress as well. If there was an attempt to reach out to her, would she be on board? Is that an option too?
Who wants to reach out to her?
KCR.
Well, I'm sure Mamata Banerjee has been always in favor of a federal front, and she will definitely try to come forward and cobble together a federal front.
Even without the Congress?
Even without the Congress, if that numbers allow that. If the numbers don't allow, I can't say for the at this point of time, but that is clearly her first preference, and people of Bengal are looking forward to Bengali-led government at the center, and to that extent, I think she will have a strong position, depending again on the numbers, but she has almost maximum in Bengal. She has 34.
But that's interesting, Pranav.
That's a very, very far shot. When my friend Nikamji was speaking, I was shaking my head vigorously, and the point that I was objecting to was, you know, this is not 2014. Please understand that it's a government that has lasted 5 years, and why should people vote for it? And my friend is here, he'll correct me. Last elections, first time voters were interviewed, and all of them don't want to vote for this government. At the same time, this year's first time voters, they are still in or with Mr. Modi. So someone who's already voted for Mr. Modi and has had a taste of it wants to get over it.
First, how do you know that?
From the experience. When you talk to people, when you interact with them, they tell you. What we hear is it's kind of a huge echo chamber.
Are you hearing something else?
No, I'm telling you what we are constantly in touch with people all across the country.
So you're thinking we are not?
Sure. I mean, please, and my facts are also right, and I honor your facts. But I'm saying it that people want to change this government. Where is the confidence? Where do you see the confidence in this government? Do you think this government has done well, performed last 5 years, and attacking a late prime minister? Why should people vote for a government which has brought the unemployment to 45 years high? Why should people vote for
those
a government?
Those are debatable points.
Which has not doubled the farmers' income.
We can have a separate discussion.
I do want to touch upon before we wrap up. Also the nature of the campaign and what kind of campaign we're seeing today, Mr. Nigam. I mean, I did briefly touch upon it in the earlier question as well. But today, again, Mr. Modi has talked about Rajiv Gandhi in this campaign. It's kind of surreal that we're talking about an assassinated former prime minister in the 2019 election campaign. Many believe it is distasteful to have crossed that red line. What do you think?
Assassination and the conduct over the period of time of the ex-prime minister are two different things. When Mr. Rajiv Gandhi himself says that only 10 paisa reaches to the people, he himself says there was a lot of corruption. So let's not connect the assassination with the conduct of the then prime minister.
Is it fair? Is it not a little bit?
See, I'm not justifying anything.
May I come in, please?
One second, Mr. Bhadauria.
Prime minister is talking about the policies of that government, the corruption that was there.
He said he died as a bhrashtachari. Was that called for?
See, let me make a distinction here. He started as a Mr. Clean person. Then subsequently what happened is a lot of questions are still unanswered at that point of time. Look at what CBI said in that order. Very serious things. They were not allowed to function properly. And if you read it, there are very serious issues also. Let me also bring on certain things on record. The entire Beaufort investigation got derailed because the source who was giving that information
was
leaked.
What stopped the Vajpayee government from prosecuting it properly? That you have to take it to the BJP.
What exactly happened?
Is it fair? Is this what our election campaign has been reduced to? Mr. Bhadauria wanted to come in. At the end of the day, Rahul keeps on saying chore and things like that. But Mr. Rajiv Gandhi was killed by terrorists and he's a former democratically elected Prime Minister of India. Is this the way the discourse should go, Mr. Bhadauria?
This shows their confidence.
Yeah, can I make a very brief point?
Yeah.
You see, I was one of the members who was part of the campaign on the issue of buffers, and Mr. Tyagi knows about it. But let me say this, that we could not prove anything. On the contrary, the Supreme Court and all the other courts and institutions have exonerated him. In spite of that, the discourse at which Modi ji has taken this whole election campaign to, this will haunt him all his life.
Fortunately, we've lost Mr. Bhadauria's line. Pranav, I'll let you finish that.
We went to election commission in the evening, and our point was that a man who becomes an MLA, from MLA he becomes a CM, and from CM becomes a PM, and you're expected to be a statesman. And what do? You go and lie down in the gutter? Is this the language of the Prime Minister? Who are you fighting? Basically, this comment is not on late Rajiv Gandhiji, this is a comment on himself, on his governance, on where he come from, what he thinks. He's exposing himself. The more he retaliates, it's his anger, it's his failure. He's trying to hide behind something imaginary.
Okay, Mr. Bhadauria, please complete your point. Yes, we've got you back.
What I'm saying is, it is this personality of Modi ji, which people of this country do not like. Everybody he pushes against the wall. He uses all kind of filthy language against each and every leader of this country. And it is for this reason that Modi ji will not return back as the Prime Minister of this country.
Well, Lalitha Kumaramangalam, just to get your thoughts on it, what does it reflect when Mr. Modi starts attacking a dead form of Prime Minister? I mean, how is Rajiv Gandhi relevant to this campaign?
Nidhi, in 2014, the massive win of the BJP was mainly, supported by the perception of the Indian peoples, the dense, extraordinarily huge amount of corruption in the UPA, especially UPA 2. Now, the comment that Mr. Modi made was saying that Rajiv Gandhi started off as Mr. Clean, but not Rajiv Gandhi, but Rahul Gandhi's father. Well, Rajiv Gandhi. But then eventually, when, the Bofors entire thing blew up in their faces, what happened to him from being Mr. Clean? Now, as one of my co-panelists said, this is not connected with the fact that he was assassinated. He was assassinated, yes, that was due to a very unfortunate thing to happen to anybody. And that is not something that should be dragged into this discussion. It has nothing to do with the comment that Mr. Modi made.
What does it have to do with the current Congress leadership?
Indira Gandhi was also
leadership.
Assassinated. And we have
what
discussed...
What does it have to do with the current...
Nidhi, is it appropriate, honestly, to sound very harsh to some of the panelists? But the fact that a Prime Minister was assassinated does not mean that his policies cannot be criticised or some of the wrongs he did cannot be criticised, especially during an election campaign.
He can be criticised, but to call him Bhrashtachari? And to say that, I mean, he's not here to defend himself. Hand on your heart,
I mean, you really think that was one of the biggest allegations against him. Nidhi, if you can say Chaukidar Chor hai with reference to the current Prime Minister, why can't you say Bhrashtachari to Mr. Rahul Gandhi, especially given the background of Bofors?
To Mr. Rajiv Gandhi, not Rahul Gandhi.
I find it very one-sided, this
it
argument.
It was to Mr.
Yours,
Rajiv Gandhi, who's dead, ma'am, who's not here to defend himself.
The party is there to defend him.
Why should they have to in 2019?
They have to,
how is Rajiv Gandhi relevant
to this
campaign? The
party is there,
obviously.
His son is
it's
there.
About corruption.
I mean, it's ridiculous to say
you
because somebody has
CWG,
died,
you can talk about UG,
you cannot criticize
you can talk about
some
all
of their
the other
wrongdoings.
Corruption cases in the, that came to light in UPA too. I'm only asking Chandan Mitra.
So
that,
what does Bhrashtachari mean in Hindi, Nidhi? It means corruption.
Nidhi, this is a very serious matter and good you raised it. My biggest problem with what Modiji said is that somehow it runs counter to the Indian parampara, which he, propagates in a big way. You see, you don't speak so ill of the dead, and that to a person who was murdered fighting terror. So I think I was quite shocked when I first heard this, that to be dragged into this election so many years after his assassination during an election campaign was, I think, pretty much below the belt and totally unwarranted. And this is not going to do Mr. Modi's image or the BJP's image any good.
Tyagi ji, I just, as an ally, I just wanted your thoughts on this comment by the Prime Minister, because, like I said, he's challenged the Congress to go and campaign in Rajiv Gandhi's name today also, so he's not backing down. But as an ally, what do you feel?
Look, Nidhi ji, two elections mein bahut hi arrogance ke saath chunav lade gaye the, ek to 77 mein. मेरे दोस्त बैठे हैं सुनील भदौरिया, ये भी जेल से निकल के आए थे हम भी, लेकिन हमने मिसेस गांधी के लिए भी इस तरह के डेरोगेटरी शब्द इस्तेमाल नहीं किए थे. फिर राजीव गांधी के खिलाफ भी हम चुनाव लड़े थे 89 में, मैं भी उस समय लोकसभा में आया था मैं, और बोफोर्स वाला मामला ऊंचे पैमाने पर था और बीपी सिंह हर मीटिंग में बोफोर्स का जिक्र करते थे. लेकिन मेरा मानना यह है कि पर्सनल अटैक एक सीमा तक होनी चाहिए, जो कि जिस परंपरा से हम लोग आए हैं पॉलिटिकल ट्रेनिंग से, उसमें इस तरह की भाषा, मैं इस भाषा का भी बहुत विरोधी हूं. आप एक देश के, दुनिया के सबसे बड़े रिपब्लिक के प्राइम मिनिस्टर को आप चोर कह सकते हो? आप पब्लिक मीटिंग में 20-30-40,000 लोगों से हाथ उठवाओगे, बोलो भाई प्रधानमंत्री चोर है? तो ये भी चंदन मित्रा जी, ये भी कोई अच्छी भाषा नहीं है. बीजेपी के कुछ मित्रों की भाषा का मैं समर्थक नहीं हूं. मैं जिस तरह की भाषा कई लोगों ने इस्तेमाल की है चुनाव में, चाहे वो प्रज्ञा ठाकुर हो, चाहे वो साक्षी महाराज हो, मैं उसको अप्रूव नहीं करता. लेकिन आप भी इसको डिसअप्रूव कीजिए कि 50,000 की पब्लिक मीटिंग में ये कहा जा रहा प्रधानमंत्री चोर है और 50,000 लोग कह रहे हैं. क्या दुनिया में आपकी इज्जत रहेगी? कौन इन्वेस्टर आएगा? तो इसको भी आप कंडेम कीजिए. हम बीजेपी के कुछ फ्रिंज एलिमेंट हैं, हम सहयोगी पार्टी हैं, हम चाहते हैं कि एनडीए की सरकार बने नरेंद्र मोदी के नेतृत्व में, लेकिन उन लोगों के ऐसे स्टेटमेंट को हम अप्रूव नहीं करते. तो हम इसको कैसे अप्रूव करेंगे कि प्रधानमंत्री चोर है? कल को ममता जी के बारे में कहने लगे, कल को माया जी के बारे में पब्लिक मीटिंग में नारे लगने लगे.
You also lowered the discourse by using the chore term against the Prime Minister repeatedly.
If you look at Congress President's interview yesterday, someone asked him, he said, I haven't coined that slogan. people have said. People have said.
That's incorrect.
Give me a minute. That I am in my speech. I am saying that चौकीदार जी कहते हैं कि मैं इस देश की रक्षा करूंगा, सुरक्षा करूंगा. Someone from the crowd says चौकीदार चोर है. And that's how it becomes.
Rahul Gandhi says it on his own.
And let me tell you. And let me tell you. Hold on.
In interviews. Yeah.
He had whole 5 years to exonerate himself, the government.
No, we're talking about the discourse. Is it possible to make the same point about the Prime Minister without using the word chor?
If you are given an opportunity to exonerate yourself, offer yourself for scrutiny. Did he allow that? Why did he do it?
Separate issue. No, is it possible to raise the same question had he allowed, without using this language?
Had he allowed, I would have taken a stand that no, then it was wrong. If it was exonerated, if the courts had tried, see what they did in the court, they hid the affidavit. They are trying to hide the affidavit.
So you are justifying the use of the language. Your boss is saying it every single day. Nilanjan, just a quick last thought on the nature of the campaign itself. I mean, is this just the new normal? Because in every election, you see the bar getting lower and lower, and you actually realize that what we thought were red lines, a new red line is created all the time. I don't think there are any lines anymore.
I think that's right. Technically, the Election Commission should be doing something to regulate the discourse, but it seems that that has fallen apart in a deeper sense. So I think once it becomes clear to all parties and all candidates that, the Election Commission really won't censure language in any serious way, then this is sort of an inevitable outcome of it. This sort of attack dog mentality.
You shouldn't need to be censured. I think it should actually be something that should be part of the public discourse from
public,
within.
Public revulsion.
Absolutely. Well, great to talk to all of you today. As I said, after round 5 is over, still 2 more rounds to go. I invite you all back once that happens. Thank you for joining us and discussing in particular both the discourse in the campaign as well as the role that potential allies could play in the future. We'll be back after this break.